please welcome Sander Duivestein. Sander, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Michiel. Good afternoon, everybody. I have 30 minutes, 45 slides, so I will be going fast. Well, utopian versus dystopian, and it immediately made me think about a famous guy, Melvin Kranzberg. He invented philosophy and technology. That was his business, that was his education, his study. And he talked about a law for technology. Technology is neither good nor bad, nor is it neutral. It totally depends nowadays on how people are using technology to change their lives, to change our businesses, to change our society. Even if you start thinking about technology in the short term, we always overestimate it. In the long run, we always underestimate it. And if we invent something, we don't even think about the side effects. And if you look at the next 10 years, some people have defined 30 technologies that are going to change our society. How are you going to cope? How are you going to deal with these technologies? Because life is changing really fast. And can we cope with the speed? So if you start thinking about this, how technology is affecting our lives, how it's accelerating our lives, can we even depend on the past anymore if we look at the future? Are there still some straight lines, or are there no more straight lines? How are we going to look at the future? And if I look at the future, if we as Vint, as SogetiLabs look at the future, we think our world will be turned upside down. From a centralized world, we are moving into a decentralized world. And if you start thinking about that, how technology is moving exponential, how people think linear, and how companies, institutions follow a different kind of curve. Are we the right people to solve these kind of issues? Are we the right people to overcome this gap or not? Maybe we are already too old. Shouldn't we depend on our children? Because they have been growing up with Wi-Fi, with the internet. So, if you start thinking about this, I have to go back to Me the Media, the first book I have written. I worked on that book in 2006. It was about the uprise of social media. And basically, if you start thinking about the era we now are living in, this new generation, they are already the media. And you see it everywhere. This picture was taken a couple of years ago. And Hillary Clinton asked the audience, "Who wants to take a picture of me?" And immediately, everybody turned their back on her. And she didn't expect that, because the selfie is more important than Hillary Clinton herself. And look at this. Some young girls at a baseball game. They have paid quite a lot of money to be at the game, but the only thing they are watching is themselves. And this is just a snapshot from 10 seconds, and the movie lasts for about 10 minutes. And look, think about Tiger Woods. 16 years ago, this picture was taken. Nobody was having a smartphone. And if you now look at the audience, everybody has a smartphone. Everybody is around Tiger Woods. Everybody becomes important. Everybody becomes the media. How are we going to deal with that? So I want to show you some examples of this new generation, of their behavior. Know your meme. This is called bouldering. People who are climbing on huge buildings, just earning page views, making a living by creating those movies. Maybe you've heard about the Tide Pod Challenge, eating stuff you normally put in your washing machine. And of course, this is not healthy, but people are doing it all around the world, making money by these challenges. And you might have heard about the Kiki Challenge, a song by Drake, a famous pop artist in the United States from Canada, and people started making funny dance movies, dance moves. KB, do you love me? Are you riding? Say you never ever leave from beside me, 'cause I want you. And I need you. Do you love me? Are you riding? Say you never ever leave from beside me, 'cause I want you. 'Cause I want you. And I need you. And I'm down for you always, baby. Do you love me? Are you riding? Say you never ever leave from beside me, 'cause I want you. Kiki, do you love me? Are you riding? Well, he wasn't really hurt bad. He had some scratches on his arm. So that's why I could show you this movie. But so the Kiki Challenge. And all these people who have become the media, they are now influencers. They are trying to influence other people. New ways of interacting with brands, new ways of interacting with institutions.
Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. My name is Stephanie, and today we are back with another dun dun mukbang! Woo!
So people are eating in front of a camera, lots and lots of food to overcome loneliness, sitting in front of a webcam, making contact with other people, and people who are watching this can give them virtual gifts so they earn a living by that. And well, I can't imagine I can eat that quite a lot of food, but strange.
What is ASMR? It stands for Autonomous Sensory Meridian Response.
And today, I would like to slow it down. So I want you to
this is a trend as well. It's called ASMR, and people who are watching this or are listening to this, you get this little itchy feeling in the back of your head. They are calling it the brain orgasm. So you might want to try it.
What do they know? What they don't know what is what. Come on. Just what is you got to show them, right? They don't know what is what. You got bars? Let's go.
This dance is called the floss. It's quite popular in the new generation as well. And these kind of dances are nowadays always in Fortnite, a game you can download for free. You can buy digital stuff, and they are earning about $300 million of dollars a month. So, and again, people are playing this. People are getting addicted to these new kind of technologies. And maybe Facebook, Twitter, Google, they have become the new drug dealers of our physical society. And will this be our future? A snapshot from the movie Wall-E. But if you look, for example, nowadays, in normal life, people are already doing it. So a movement like Time Well Spent that tries to overcome this addiction to new technologies, this might be a solution. But is this the only solution, or are there more problems? Because if you now look at society, at media, is it real or is it fake? Fake news? How is exchanging affecting our lives? This is Hatsune Miku, a virtual pop star, very famous in Japan. It's a hologram. People are going to a concert to watch a hologram, and I always ask myself why. And she will be in Paris this year in December, and I've bought two tickets for myself and for my wife, and I don't know how to explain her what we are going to do. So, but I think it will be fun. Maybe you've seen this this girl. She's 19 years old. She's Brazilian, American. Little Michaela, she's called. She has about 1.5 million followers on Instagram. So I think she has more followers on Instagram than we as a room. But she is well supported by all kinds of brands, clothing brands. But she doesn't exist. She is totally digital. She lives a digital life in Instagram. And she even recorded her new single with a famous producer, Steve Bauer. Well, this is what, just one of the first virtual influencers. Maybe you've seen this character. She is called Shudogram. She's the first, she's world's first digital supermodel. She doesn't exist at all. But if you look at her and you look at her friends, these girls, these women aren't real at all. But even a big warehouse like Balmain, they hire these people. You can even buy them online. They start working for you. Working for you, think about, for example, this character, Nunuri, 16 years old, has about 800,000 followers on Instagram as well. And she, well, she is the new brand for fashion. On this side, you see Eva. She's a digital human, a receptionist. She works for Autodesk. So if you visit Autodesk, you can talk with her. And think about this guy.
Hello. My name is Daniel Kalt, Regional Chief Investment Officer of UBS in Switzerland. I will help you navigate financial markets. What would you like to know?
Daniel Kalt, the Chief Economist for the UBS Bank. And they have recorded him by using 172 cameras. They have virtualized him. They have put IBM Watson technology underneath him, so he has now become artificially intelligent. And at every consultancy event, a consultancy meeting, he is there in a TV screen. You can ask him questions. Very scalable technology. We are photoshopping the world. And this, well, we use this technology like Photoshop for about 10 years ago, but if you now look at what's happening with your mobile phone, you can render the environment real time. Just a guy in front of a green screen. But look what you see on your phone or on your television. How can we trust this technology? And it might be fun, or it is fun. It's Snapchat filters. Our children are used to these kind of technologies. And this is just fun. We laugh about it. But if you think about deepfake technology, taking the face of a celebrity and putting it on the body of a porn star, creating sex tapes for celebrities they didn't act in, how will this affect our society? And what about voice? Baidu has developed technology that listens to your voice for 3 seconds and it can reproduce your voice. And think about Google Duplex.
Hello, how can I help you?
Hi, I'm calling to book a women's haircut for a client. I'm looking for something on May 3rd.
Sure, give me 1 second.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. She acts like a human, but she's completely digital. Do we want this or not? So, it's a complete meltdown of trust. It's happening in our society everywhere. And Michiel already showed this graph. It's a battle for the truth. It's a crisis in trust. And if you look at the newspapers, if you look at the magazines, the FIFA is corrupt. We don't trust Zuckerberg anymore. The church is attacking our children. Well, it's Trump, the Me Too movement. It's basically everywhere. And again, it's still happening. So how are we going to react on this topic? How are we going to trust technology? How are we going to trust each other? Cambridge Analytica. The company that used our Facebook accounts to basically misinform us about Brexit, about Trump. And this is a movie, a snapshot. It was taken 2 years ago.
If we wanted to drill down further, we could resolve the data to an individual level, where we have somewhere close to 4,000 or 5,000 data points on every adult in the United States.
5,000 data points for every adult in the United States. And this was a movie 2 years ago. And we're only discussing it for half a year now. And what about China? The citizen index, where they can record every movement of their people. And this is a little movie from an investigator, a journalist from BBC. And he went to China and he asked the Chinese government, can you please make me a criminal on your network so I can understand what's happening when I walk outside?
Well, let's see how long it takes you to find me. Thank you very much. Let's go.
Well, here we are then. I've just got out of the car, close to the city centre, and for the purposes of this exercise, the plan is for me to start walking in the direction of the bus station. My image has already been flagged to the authorities as a suspect, and in theory, it should only be a matter of time.
Uh-oh.
Right behind me, you can see, just over my left shoulder there.
Hello.
Hello, guys.
Where's you?
I've been expecting you. Ah, maybe these guys aren't in on the joke.
7 minutes and then the network recognizes you. Do we want this technology or not? And so who do we have to trust in the future? Is it people? Is it code? Rachel Bosman, she has written a book. It's called Who Do You Trust? And she makes this movement possible. She's talking about how we are evolving as human beings, as institutions, as companies. We are moving in an era where we can trust the code, where we can trust the protocol, where we can trust companies like Uber, platforms like Airbnb. We invite strangers into our bedrooms. And even an application like Tinder. People are using Tinder to find their life partner. So we are trusting the code again and again. And there was this, talking about trust, they had this meeting at the World Economic Forum. And as you can see, Rachel Bosman's over there. Famous people, and they had this huge discussion. What's happening with our society? And they came up with three problems. It's a disruption of reality. We don't know what's real or not, fake or not. It's the power of those big companies like Facebook, like Apple, like Microsoft. They are owning our data, and basically we have lost the control of our data. Is this the future we want to have? These were the questions they asked themselves. And then in the audience there was this guy, Don Tapscott, one of the most world-famous internet gurus. And he said, well, if these are the problems, I think I have a solution. I can develop technology. I can use, for example, blockchain to make things real again. What's reality? What's equality? How are we going to overcome this monopoly power? And sovereignty? How are we going to own our own data again? This was his promise. We are now entering into an era where we can use our own data to make a shift, a power shift. This is the old model where the companies like Microsoft, Google, and Facebook are, where they're owning our data. And we are now can use technologies like, for example, blockchain, where we can make a shift. We are the owner of our own data. We are now moving into an era. The web 3.0 era, the decentralized web, is coming our way. And if this is the movement, and these might be little startups, but last week, Tim Berners-Lee, his new startup, where we can, basically give we get control of our own identity because he is using blockchain technology, where we have the ownership of our data. Is this going to change our lives or not? How fast is this going to happen? And basically what we are now seeing is that every company has the risk of being disrupted by a trusted version of ourselves. How will this future look like? And I am optimistic. If you look at the evolution of the internet, in 1997 it was the browser wars, Internet Explorer, Netscape, where we had the first websites. We could click on them by a mouse. 2007, the first smartphone, mobile first. The app stores, we could touch apps with our thumb, with our finger. Then 2017, Alexa, Microsoft Cortana, Samsung Bixby, Amazon Echo, AI first, artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence, agents where we can talk to with our human voice, where the voice becomes a new conversation, the new interface. And for the next years, digital avatars that are at our side, that knows us because we have control of our data. We give it to our own avatars. So human first will be the next step. The technology is helping us. And technology is helping us. I think for the next day, for the next 2 days, it will be about three things. If we are talking about in code we trust, it will be about trusting behavior, trusting the behavior of this new generation. It will be about trusting management, different governance models, the Web 3.0 from centralized into a decentralized world. And last but not least, trusting technology, algorithms that know us. So lots of stuff to cover for the next 2 days. So thank you.
I wanted to check if you're real and not a hologram. So thank you very much. Thank you. Sander Duivestein.